Welcome to this presentation. Since you just saw a very similar presentation, there will be quite some overlap because we, Josef and I, try to tackle more or less the same problem. This work was done in cooperation with our neighboring institute, the Visual Computing Institute. They are visualizing the simulations that the HPC users calculate on our machine. And so the yeah just don't please don't take the name that we propose not for given. Continuation as Josef proposes, probably as le at least as good. So the motivation for this work was that the VR guys, they have this code to trace particles and visualize the particles. And this code is built on Booth MPI and is also using Intel thread building blocks. They have a static partitioning of the problem using MPI, but then they also have load balancing where they locally decide to move work to the neighbors, which works quite good. But there's still potential for improvement because currently they don't overlap computation and communication. And so introducing non-blocking communication could significantly improve the performance of the code. And so here you can see more or less the big building blocks of the code, where we have a load balancing step that uses, as I said, near neighboring communication to exchange data with the neighbors. And then there is calculation that does the work. And then when a step, a time step is finished, they need to redistribute the particles that left the boundaries. And they also need to check for completion of the simulation of the visualization. And so all these steps could be improved significantly with non-blocking communication. But then this would mean that the code would need to keep track of the requests that are created, and then at some point wait for the requests to get the right semantic. And the other motivation was that I saw Josef's talk at IBOM 2 years ago, where he presented this Kolesky code with tasks that have dependencies with other tasks, but now this is translated into a distributed version, so that some of the tasks actually run on a different MPI process, and then to move the data from one task to the other task, MPI communication is necessary. And we could encapsulate the MPI communication in tasks, have dependencies for this communication task, and then also outgoing dependencies for the receiving tasks. And so most of this you already have seen in Josef's talk. And yeah, he also introduced the task-aware MPI implementation, which is a specific implementation that approaches this problem, but it's not really portable, and it's not compatible a compatible solution with other MPI implementations. And so what we were looking for is an interface for MPI that tries to solve the problem, but still keeps the communication semantic inside MPI and separates it from other semantics like tasking. Then we also look at other people, what they are looking for. And then in the MPI forum, we found an issue where someone has on the wish list that they would like to use the C++ continuation to write code that looks like this, where you can do a MPI gather, and then depending on the completion of the MPI gather, the root would execute something with the buffer. Then a broadcast is executed. When this broadcast is finished, then the next step is done. And the interesting thing here is that until you really wait for this future that is returned from all those continuations, you don't know whether this is finished or not. And but with the future get, you're guaranteed that all this is done, and then you can move on. And so this is also something where we will see how we can address this with the solution that we developed. Then the other thing is that OpenMP also in the same time frame, it was 2018 when Josef had the talk in OpenMP 5.0, the detach clause was introduced. And the detach clause for OpenMP tasks allows to say when the task is finished, it's not completed, it just finished execution, and only when a certain function is called, then the task completes, and only when the task really completes, then this out dependency is resolved. And a task that has this has an independency on this out dependency can then start executing. So the idea is that we want to use non-blocking communication in a task, and then we want to depend the completion of the task on the completion of this request. But we are not really interested in coming back to the task and continue execution. What we think is that this is something where MPI should help and signal that the request is completed, and we can move on. So what we developed is a function that is similar to the continuation function that Josef presented. We pass in a request to this detach function, and so we can compare this with an MPI wait. So for MPI wait, we also pass in a request handle, and then what we also pass in is a callback function, and the callback function will be called when the request is completed. And then for to signal some additional information from this detach call to the callback, there is this extra void pointer argument so that we can transfer some state. Now, what we also need is, and what we also have in the MPI wait, we have this we have the status argument. And so here we think that the status argument is something that should directly go to the callback, because that's the thing that responds to this finished communication, and to have also the ability of saying, okay, I'm not really interested in the status. We need a second version where the the callback function does not take the status argument. And so we have a second version of this detach function that says, okay, I'm not I will not be interested in the status, but this is basically the equivalent to the to passing MPI status ignore to an MPI wait call. Okay, and then of course we also have MPI wait, and we have an equivalent here where we say only when all of the requests are completed, then we want to get this callback. And of course, we also have a variant for passing MPI status, statuses ignore, where we are not interested in the status argument. And when you look into the paper or into our implementation, there's also a variant where we say detach many. That's similar to the MPI wait some, wait any, where the MPI implementation has the potential to optimize the finishing of multiple MPI. Of multiple requests. Then the other thing that Josef also had in his talk, and so we really think that this is something where MPI should really create provide an interface, is the problem of driving progress in the communication. And so the general problem here is that the communication can get stuck in at multiple steps in a process, and so there might be the need that MPI needs to get active to move the buffer forward towards the receiver, and so with the MPI with this callback based completion of the request, we will not have further calls into the MPI library to allow the MPI library get active and move forward in a communication. Of course, an implementation is free to drive the progress without getting actively called, like some implementations have a progress thread, or they use some hardware facility to guarantee and drive the progress. But in a general case, we need some way to trigger the MPI library and allow the continuation of the communication. And so what we propose is that a new function is added that can be implemented as a no-op if the implementation says, okay, we have other means of driving progress, but it allows the library to drive the communication and move forward in the communication. And then this function can be registered by some polling service to drive the communication. And the only thing that we need from this function for our extension is that at some point the callback that registers with a detach function will be invoked when the communication is completed. So it could also be seen as a regular calling to MPI test for the request that we detached. Now for the usage, we can wrap this MPI detach function into a C++ future. And so we have this detach as a future. We pass in an MPI request. The return value is a future. And so We create a promise, get the future from that. And then what we have here is this MPI detach function gets a request, and then the callback is here a lambda function which takes the promise and registers this lambda function with a detach, and then when the communication is completed, the promise sets the value so that the future is completed, and that means when the detach function calls the lambda, the future will be completed. And then this can be used to implement functions like this gather, where we get as a return this future. And I mean, there would be more code necessary, but this is something that can be used to implement this. So now to the actual OpenMP tasking use case. The code I showed earlier was not the actual code that you would write to use this in OpenMP. Here we now have the actual code. So we in OpenMP, we have this event handle, which is used in a detach call. And then to really complete the OpenMP task, this event handle needs to be passed into the OpenMP fulfill event function. And with this interface, we can directly register the OMP fulfill event function as a callback, pass in the event handle here as the void pointer argument, and then when the communication is completed, the MPI library will call this function, pass in this this argument, and with this, the task is completed and the our dependency is resolved, and then the next task can start executing. Of course, we also did an evaluation of our implementation to showcase that this actually works. We implemented this as an PMPI wrapper, and we used the code that Josef prepared for IBOM with this distributed block Kolesky factorization. And what we did there is we now used MPI, the new MPI detach function in these send and receive tasks, so that these tasks get really asynchronous, and as soon as they posted the MPI communication, they will not be called anymore. And when the MPI library says, okay, the communication is completed, the callback is called, then the outward dependencies are resolved, and this code can execute. So what we will compare in the next slides is an implementation that uses a single task for the communication. This is something that Josef showed. This is the baseline, which is with current OpenMP and MPI valid code, and cannot deadlock. The other versions of the code, especially the task yield code, that's what he showed in the paper. This version can work if the with the right OpenMP implementation, but it is not portable because the semantics that OpenMP guarantees for the task yield are too weak. And then we have the we have two implementations. One is where we use the detach function and the OpenMP detach clause. And then a second one where we also utilize the polling service of OMS 2 to drive the MPI progress. So in a first experiment, we use one node of 48 core machine here in Aachen. And these are two socket machines, and the details about the architecture are in the paper. But the CPUs have two subnumber domains, and so they are running in this subnumber clustering mode. And so this is the reason why with one MPI process and 48 OpenMP threads, we see a longer execution time in a calculation. So what we see here in the blue, that's the time spent in the Intel MKL to really do the numeric algebra. And then all the blue is the code around those around those MKL cores, and with one MPI process, we see NUMA effects, meaning we see that we have remote NUMA accesses across the socket border, and then also with two MPI processes and 24 threads. We still see slight NUMA effects, so the execution time is still a bit longer than when we restrict the multi-threading to the borders of the sub-NUMA domain. And so what we want to compare here is so what we have here on the left, that's the implementation that worked with current OpenMP and MPI. Then this is an implementation using task yield where we can see, okay, with these fine grain, with this more fine grain communication tasks, we can actually achieve better performance using OMS. So making the communication more fine-grained can help to improve performance. Unfortunately, this version cannot be run with a Clang OpenMP runtime because there it would deadlock. Then with a detach implementation, we see that for a higher number of processes, we get less overhead from the parallel runtimes. And then the main reason why we have this comparison here is that the OMS2 implementation is the only of the OpenMP tasking runtimes that has this polling service available. And we wanted to see whether using this polling service inside of the tasking runtime gives us an improvement. For these two measurements, our PMPI wrapper has spawns an additional thread that works as a progress thread and that repeatedly just calls into this MPI progress calls regularly MPI tests for all the requests that are detached. Now to go to a higher scale, we also did some strong scaling experiment where we now use the partitioning where we have four processes on one node, and then we scale up to 32 nodes, 128 processes, and the top and the bottom, they show exactly the same execution, just the display is different. In the top, we see the execution time per thread, and then on the bottom, we see the aggregated runtime when we sum up the execution time of all threads and processes. So this is, again, this is the implementation using the detach functionality, the OpenMP detach clause, and our MPI detach function. And when we compare it with, I mean, the fairest comparison is to compare it with this single, with a task that uses only a single communication task. And here we can see that for lower processes, we achieve quite some performance improvement. And then also for higher processes, we also achieve quite some performance improvement. And then for the polling service, we can see, okay, it has no negative effect, but we cannot assert that using polling service really has a benefit over using our own thread to drive the progress. Okay, so let's come to a conclusion. What I showed here in this talk was a slim extension of MPI, just introducing a couple of new functions to provide asynchronous local completion. It works with OpenMP tasks and C++ futures, but in general, it should also apply to other tasking models, to fibers or whatever Yusuf introduced in his talk. A prototype of this is available as a PMPI wrapper, so this is this can be used with any MPI implementation. It's just 300 lines of code. It's thread safe. You can use it with MPI thread multiple. Then the code used for the performance study is also available. What we missed during the implementation was a functionality to query for a given MPI request, whether it is a persistent request or not. This was something also described in the paper, where we actually had to implement additional PMPI functions to collect this information. The next step, since I'm also working in the OpenMP language committee, is pushing forward so that we get a polling service interface in OpenMP, and then we can register such a progress function in the MPI library. And with that, I thank you for your attention, and I'm looking for feedback or questions or anything.
Thank you, Joaquin. Okay, let's see if there is any question. So just a doubt I have in the strong scaling experiment.
Yes.
You are using 1, 2, 4 nodes, no? Increasingly, because yes. Okay. Because I didn't.
So it's one node, two nodes, four node.
Okay. So it looks like the scalability it stops around three nodes. I have four nodes for clan, for instance.
Yes, but I mean, it's a really small problem size. And I mean, if you would do a weak scaling, and I mean, the problem why we did not add a weak scaling experiment is the problem is not well suited for to just double the problem with doubling the processes. So that's why we went for this strong scaling experiment. But I mean, you could also run the same experiment with bigger problem size, and then it would scale better.
Okay, no, because in the previous slide, the slide before this one, looked like the single comp in clan perform quite well, right?
So in this experiment, it's always the same problem, and it's always using one node. And the only thing that we vary is how many threads versus how many MPI processes we use.
Okay. So thanks for the.
At the end, it's 16 MPI processes and 3 threads.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.